క్లాస్లోనే మీటింగ్ ఆన్లైన్లోనే ఎత్తున్నారా? ఎక్కువ వస్తుంది, అట్లీస్ట్ మ్యూట్ అయినా చేసుకోండి. ఓకే గైస్, హూ ఇస్ స్టార్టెడ్ దట్ క్లాస్? యా, అది ఆపేయండి, అది ఆన్ చేసినప్పుడు ఆపటం తెలియాలి సార్. ఓకే యా, సో యెస్టర్డే ఇట్ వాజ్ అ టెక్నికల్ గ్లిచ్ అండ్ ఆబ్వియస్లీ ఇట్ విల్ హ్యావ్ సమ్ పెయిన్ పాయింట్స్ ఆన్ అస్. ఓకే, సో ద బేసిక్ ఎజెండా వాజ్ యా అపార్ట్ ఫ్రమ్ దట్ మై డిసిప్లిన్. ఓకే, సో వన్ ఇస్ యెస్టర్డే మై ఎజెండా వాజ్ టు ఫినిష్ ద కుబెర్నెటిస్ ఆస్పెక్ట్స్ అండ్ టుడే టు డిస్కస్ ద సేమ్ ఆన్ అజూర్. ఓకే, but that is completely ruined now, so probably some of the aspects will move to the next weekend. Okay, so today we will discuss Kubernetes. Okay, and let us see how much we can complete, and if the leftovers of Kubernetes and Docker stack, we have to take it over the next weekend. So that's unfortunate reality, and I can't really help it. Yeah, okay, fine. So if I am not wrong, just remind me, we have discussed till this point, right? We have discussed about what pods are and what services are, yeah, at an overview. Okay, because if every pod gets an IP address and other pod uses its IP address, a pod can die and it can come up with a new IP address, and if you use IP address directly in the pod, your application might go wrong. So that's why we use services. That was the last topic, I think, if I'm not wrong, what we discussed. Yeah, okay. 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 Wonderful. Every pod gets what? One IP address? Yes. And in the pod, can I have more than one container? Yes. Possibility is there, but will we? No. Okay. So you should not. But sometimes we can't help it. All right. So I think we have discussed about this also. When I speak about pod scaling, I am not increasing containers in pod, I am increasing pods itself. Yeah, okay, and pod life cycle as well. Good. Services, I discussed about this as well. So whenever, rather than using pod by its IP address, we would use it by either by services DNS name or services IP address, so that if any pods go wrong, okay, it would be easy. And version upgrades also will be easy, right? Because pod knows what the other pods are by labels. All right, okay, good, wonderful. Now generally when we deploy any container in any world, let it be any application, let us not just speak about container, it will have new versions coming up, right? And whenever new versions come up, you have to deploy them to production, obviously. So let us assume that you were working on version 1.0. Probably in some time, the time depends on your organization, you will have a version 1.1, right? So whenever this happens, okay, how do you deal with that in Kubernetes is what this deployment is all about. Okay, fine. So in Kubernetes, you would define a deployment as a declarative language and you would give it to your kube cluster store, right? Yes, mana kube clusters chodte nika direct ga matladedi. So what is the component of the server which we directly speak with? API server. Thanks. So we give the manifest file to API server, and API server does whatever you have written in that manifest. So in this manifest, till now we were discussing about pods and services. Now we go one level above that. We say that I want a deployment. Okay, and in the deployment, you will tell what is that you want. So this deployment consists of the following containers. So you might say that I want some pod with four replicas of it. Okay, so let us assume that this is a web server. So you got four web servers. Okay, and now this is basically the best part of deployment. Okay, basically every Kubernetes object is a persistent object, so we have REST objects over there. Okay, and the best thing which you can do out of this is you can commit the new version or roll back the current version. So for example, now 1.1 comes into play. Okay, you would change in your manifest file and you would say that now I am going to deploy a version which is 1.1. Okay, and you would basically tell your strategy. So for example, if I have four machines up, I would say that, okay, let us do it this way. Let us not basically shut down all the four. Let us bring down or bring up the new version first and shut down one machine. So slowly what happens is you have four older versions of the containers. One will become off, the other one comes up. Okay, similarly, all the four will be shut down and you'd have all the four containers with the newer versions of it. Wonderful. That's good. Okay, so that's what this deployment does. But there is one more advantage to it. Probably, let us assume that your 1.1 version has some issues and your customer doesn't like it. Now, what is that you have to do? You have to go back to 1.0. And generally, it directly supports rollback. So there is no need for you to upload any file. You have to just execute one more command saying that, okay, this version is somehow not working. Please take me to the older version. And that would be done. And every change which you've done on the deployment will be recorded and a history of it would be maintained. So whenever something goes wrong, it is very easy basically to switch back to the older version. So commit and roll back. So these are the two important things which we speak about deployments. This is a very difficult thing to achieve, okay, if you are doing it by any other means. But Kubernetes has done all of its work. The only thing which you need to tell about is strategy if you want to change it. Otherwise, Kubernetes has its own strategy, zero downtime deployment without you making any effort. That's the deployment over here. Okay, we'll be looking at how to do all of this also. Okay, so pod speaks about an individual work. Service speaks about a collection of related work. For example, I want a collection of basically web servers. I want a collection of cache servers. I want a collection of DB servers. Then you do that. And last one is deployment. Okay, so what this deployment does is this deployment basically ensures that you can safely upgrade, okay, or degrade your versions in a simplest terminology. But upgrade and degrade is something which we speak, but in real time you have to, or in general it is called as, in deployment world it is popularly called as committing and rollbacking the versions. So you can commit to the new version and you can roll back to any other version. So that's the whole stuff around it. Good. Okay, good. I think we know this, installing Kubernetes. All right, I'm not going to discuss about all of these aspects, but Kubernetes has many installations. It's just not like Docker having two or three variants. It has, if I'm not wrong, it has approximately 100 variants of installing Kubernetes. Okay, and we can't see all. The approach which we have seen with respect to kubeadmin, right? Kubeadmin is the easiest one, and Kubernetes is working on it, and it will become production grade very soon. But as on today, it is not production grade, so you cannot use kubeadmin for production. And you are seeing something called as Minikube. Okay, Minikube is to simulate in your local machine. So basically, when you install Minikube, and it uses the local virtual machine. It could be VirtualBox or Hyper-V. And it would create one cluster there. And you can, if you want to simulate Kubernetes in your local environments, you can use Minikube. Okay, so Minikube is documented, but I'll not be discussing about that. Okay, so basically the commands don't change, but initially you have to use the minikube command line. Okay, fine. And next is you would have something called as hosted solutions. Okay, hosted solutions are like the solution which I want to speak in Azure Container Services. Amazon is working on the preview version. It is not released yet. Okay, it is Elastic Kubernetes Services, and Google has a compute engine, container engine. GKE is what they call. Yeah, and apart from that, you have Cloud Foundry's one. You have many OpenShift from Red Hat, which basically supports Kubernetes. Now even Docker Enterprise supports Kubernetes. There are many, many places where you get this. Okay, and there is some other thing which is called as turnkey solutions. One is directly installing it. Okay, dev environment, minikube. Okay, and then hosted environments, the cloud providers. Okay, and then basically there is something called as turnkey. Turnkey is images which are being created, and you can click on that images and they would work it for you. That is the third kind of a deployment. And fourth is take a bare metal and install it on your own. Okay, so there are in this each category, there are not less than 10 to 15 ways of installing Kubernetes. Okay, so you might choose whatever makes sense. Okay, so for simulating, for dev and test environments, kubeadmin is the most safest and the easiest way. All right, but if you go to the production, you have to basically take one of the deployments over here. All right, okay, so we will be using kubeadmin plus Azure Container Services. That's what we would cover in our curriculum over here. Okay, minikube, the installation steps are over here. Please do this how to do this. Or if you don't want to do all of this, you just use Choco install minikube. If you don't want to do all of this on your Windows machine, use Choco install minikube. All right. And kubeadmin, we know this. We have done this. All right. So it has all the steps over here. Okay. Now, this is where it becomes interesting. Now, to Kubernetes, there are two ways of speaking with Kubernetes. One they call as an imperative way, the other one they call it as a declarative way. Imperative way is when you execute the command, when you say that kubectl run, okay, something like pod, and you just tell what your pod is. That is a CLI way of doing it. You can do that. Okay, just like how we were executing our Docker commands. Docker run nginx, this is an imperative way. Because whenever you want to reproduce this, you have to retype your command. Or the other way is whatever you want to be done on the pod, you write it in the format of a file. Put that file in a version control system. And whenever you want to basically use that, you can just clone that git and basically run it. That is a declarative way. That is an advantage of a declarative way. So if you are going for a declarative model, you write once and use it many times. If you go for an imperative way, you write every time. Okay, so for simple commands to check, imperative is good. But whenever you are seeking long-term approach, it will not work out. So our focus is not at all on imperative. We'll be looking at declarative. So whenever you say declarative, we have to write some file. We have to write some file. And the file can be written in JSON or YAML. But YAML is more popular here. I don't know the reason. Generally, JSON is popular, but in Kubernetes world, YAML is popular. Okay, so let us just have the first basically version of the YAML. Okay, how do we write YAMLs and all of that? Okay, so YAML is nothing but collection of key value pairs. At its very simpler level, YAML is nothing but a collection of key value pairs. Okay, so let me write some YAML syntaxes so that we'll understand what is the context for it. Okay. Let me do this. Okay. YAML will have a key and a value. So for example, if I want to write a name colon k it is. Right? And then, for example, you want to define other key, okay? Topic colon containers. Simple. It is a collection of key value pair. So whenever you want to tell about the things, you would be telling about basically dividing them in key value pairs. Now let us assume that you want to tell multiple things about it. Sometimes the things which you want to tell is very simple. Name, just tell what the name is. And now if you want to speak about address, there are two ways of dealing with address. One is you write all of the address in a simple string, or you break your address into multiple lines, because that might be necessary. You might be writing lane 1, lane 2, basically city, state and country. So in this case, you can't tell about address as one string. You have multiple fields in it, right? So this kind of declaration is called as complex kind of a declaration, right? Avuna edanna oka anything which you, if you want to describe, there are two ways of looking at it. Can I describe it in one statement? Okay, so student in quality dot, can I tell in one statement string? No, I have to tell multiple things about it. So let us try to write about one student now. So student will have name, okay, mobile number, right, some number, okay, and what are the other things? Courses, I'll come back to it later. Okay, probably a quality dot ID. They would be using some numbering, right? Yeah. So these are the three things. Okay. This file is about a student. Okay. So it has all the student details. Now let us assume that I want to write a file. Okay. Where I would tell about a course, and in that course, I have to tell about one student. So since this file was only for student, it was okay. I would have directly written the stuffs. So now what I have to do is, okay, I'm going to write a file which is about a course. And in this course, I have to write about one student. Later on, let us increase it for multiple students. Okay, let us see how it goes. So name, Kubernetes. Okay, as topic, let me write it as DevOps. Okay. Student info. The problem is I can't write the student info at one shot over here, because I'm dealing with multiple fields. So student info should contain multiple informations of the student. Do you agree to that? Yes. So now I'm trying to write about the student info, which is information, but this information cannot be written in one line. So if it was one line, I would have written that this is student info or something like that. But that is not the case over here. So to tell that it is a child, see where it starts from. Give two spaces to it. You can give any number of spaces. I'm just telling two because two is used as a standard. Okay. This indentation is basically derived from Python. Okay. So you can use any number. You can use give three also. But throughout the file, you have to give three. Generally, people tend to give two spaces. So I'm doing the same thing. Now here you write name colon test, mobile colon whatever it is, and ID colon. So here what I'm trying to do is I'm trying to tell about an student any information. If they are simply written, I can directly write it as a value. But if it is a child info, then I have to tell at a position which starts from two spaces after the parent. Good. Yeah. Now I have to tell, I've told about Kubernetes, right? So let us assume that generally for Kubernetes, do you have one student or multiple students? We'll have multiple students. So this structure is not something right. All right. So in that case, what you would do is you would just say students info. Okay. And you would have multiple students to deal with. Okay. Just give hyphen. Okay. And hyphen, you can start from the same position as the parent, or you can give two spaces. Anything is fine. Okay. So hyphen is a list item. Array item, right? So I'll go over here, and now if I want to write about other student, I'll just say hyphen, and then again I'll start from the same line, name. Okay, again if I have to write about other student, I'll give hyphen, name. So I have three hyphens for the student info, which means that I have three students' information. Good? Yeah, just remember this basics. I am not stressing this too much on YAML because our next 2 weeks of journey will basically majorly rely on YAML. We'll be learning the complete YAML in Ansible, because in Ansible you have to deal only with YAML files, right? So I want to just introduce you to this much key and a value. And in key value, you have two things. Whether your value is simple or complex. If it is complex and single, you will be starting from two spaces after it and you would be writing, because it is a child of the parent information. And whenever you want to deal with multiple things, you would be putting hyphens. Hyphen means list items, right? Good. Okay. Fine. Voice is breaking. Okay. Is it breaking only for Shivkumar, or is it breaking for everyone? Yeah. Can we use Kubernetes through web UI to manage pods? See, I said that there are many ways of installing Kubernetes, right? So there are some third-party solutions also, like OpenShift, Tectonic, and all of that. These guys give you UI. Okay. In the class, I will not deal with UI. I don't want you to make it lazy, because learning UI is not a very difficult job. You will have the whole list of things, whatever we do. What is that UI does? Whatever commands which you are typing, it will be projected on the UI. So I am really not interested in UI, and I don't think so you should be interested in UI. Right? Because your interviews happen on CLI, not on UI. Right? Good. Okay. Fine. So we will be using this kind of YAML files with some structure to basically create pods, to create services, to create deployments. Right? That's the first thing. And now, the problem with Kubernetes documentation is their documentation is more focused towards using Kubernetes from Go library and Python library. So if you go into Kubernetes, you might not really find the syntactical references. The only thing which you have to search for is examples. Unfortunately, that is a reality, because decoding that objects into YAML files is not that simple. Okay? Because whatever we are doing in YAML, Kubernetes can be spoken in three ways. One is from imperative way, use command line. Second is using the declarative way, like what I am trying to do. The third one is go and create a Go library and use it from your code. Okay? Or go and create a Python library and use it from your code. These are the only ways. So Kubernetes documentation is more lenient towards the third way and the first way, not the second way. Okay? The only way to deal with second is go with examples. Look at the examples, understand the examples, copy them and reuse them. Okay, so that's what our approach would be. YAML swantanga raayatam kallu moosukona raayatam kudaradu. Unfortunately, you have to take an example and copy it, because syntactical changes we never know. Okay, so we'll be copying YAML from multiple places, understanding what each key and value means, and then we'll be applying. Fine. Okay, I'm not saying that there is no documentation. There is no clear documentation like what they do for imperative and using Kubernetes from code. Okay. Good. So we know the concept, right? We have to write some manifest file, okay, which is in YAML format. Give it to your API server. So giving to the API server is done by an installation or a component in Kubernetes, which we use, is called as kubectl. Okay, and we speak with nodes, right? Nodes, node alone ga in the API server. Yes, API server node lo untada, master lo untada? Yeah, mari yes ani enduku antunaru? Okay, so the only component which you would be speaking for making anything happen is manager. For accessing what we have created, we might go to the nodes in some other alternative ways. Are we good? So basically, whenever you're dealing with Kubernetes, the manifest files will be given to your masters. Okay, I'm saying masters because there can be one or more. Okay, if they want a high availability setup, they would have more than one master, because even if one master fails, they don't want the Kubernetes to be down. That's a high availability setup. And we would be writing some file. We would be using a kubectl command, and kubectl commands for really using this manifest files are very simple. Okay. Let us try to apply that. Fine. So this we know, right? Okay. Pod will have its own execution area. In that execution area, you can have one container or more than one container. Okay. My examples don't cover multiple containers because philosophically I'm against it. If you are doing this, your design is not right. Yesterday I have spoken to one of our students and he was telling that in their company they are using five containers in a pod. And one of the developer has given 11 containers in a pod. So that is not a pod, that is a virtual machine. You should not call it as a pod then. Okay. Because architecturally it is wrong. Okay. Pod is something which you can scale to as many things as you want. దాంట్లో పదకొండు పెట్టేశారంటే అప్లికేషన్ పెట్టేసినట్టు. ఇఫ్ ఎ పాడ్ ఇస్ కంటైనింగ్ 11 కంటైనర్స్ దట్ మీన్స్ దట్ దీస్ గైస్ హ్యావ్ జస్ట్ ఫిట్టెడ్ కుబర్నెటాస్ టు దర్ పర్పస్ బట్ రియలీ నాట్ అప్లైడ్ కుబర్నెటాస్. ఇప్పుడు స్కేల్ చేసినప్పుడు ప్రతి కుబర్నెటాస్ ఈజ్ అ హెవీ మెషిన్. ఇఫ్ యూ వాంట్ టు రన్ 11 కుబర్నెటాస్, లెట్ అస్ అస్యూమ్ అట్ అ సింప్లర్ నోట్ ఈచ్ కంటైనర్ టేక్స్ 512 MB. సో వాట్ ఇస్ ద సైజ్ ఆఫ్ పాడ్ దెన్? 5.5 GB. Okay, plus 500 GB, let us assume 500 MB, let us assume that it takes for its own maintenance. Okay, so 6 GB of pod, that is a joke. Okay, even if you go to Google with that, they would say first break it up. Okay, fine. Ante anni andulone pettes untaru pod lo db anni okate pod ayipoyind application. But when you want to scale, it is no different than what is happening right now. You can't scale them. Okay, that's the other problem. Fine. But unfortunately, sometimes developer comes and tell these things to you, and you should be able to express this. That's why I'm trying to tell that. And yesterday I've told to him the same stuff. You should be debating with your developers then. Why do you want to have all the 11 in one pod, or all the 5 in one pod, or all the 2 in one pod? Make them microservices. Okay, because the whole point of going to Docker is because you want to host smaller services. And now again, if you give me a huge setup and you say, just say that because I have Kubernetes, I want to use it, better go for virtual machine or go into EC2 machine, do this 11 installations on one huge machine of 10 GB and scale them. Auto scaling account, you don't need Kubernetes at all for that purposes. Are we good? Yes. Okay, we will have pod communication, because remember yesterday we have installed while we were when we have finished kube admin. Okay, when we have said get nodes, it was saying not ready. Okay, but when we have installed something called as kube apply minus f and I have given some path of weave.net, okay, and then it has started, it is saying that it has said that it is ready. Okay, the reason is the networking component, the kube proxy. Okay, so the kube proxy, there are multiple variants to it. We have used weave.net. okay, there are many other third party services over there which will enable the communication between pods irrespective of where your nodes are. Okay, and one thing for sure is, we have discussed this, and again I am telling that whenever you are saying that I am forming a cluster, you cannot form a cluster between machines which cannot communicate. That is a ground principle. నేను క్లస్టర్ ఫామ్ చేస్తున్నాను అంటే మై బేసిక్ అసంప్షన్ ఇస్ ఐ ఆమ్ గ్రూపింగ్ ఆల్ ద మెషిన్స్ విచ్ కెన్ కమ్యూనికేట్ విత్ ఈచ్ అదర్. దే మైట్ నాట్ బి ఇన్ ద సేమ్ ప్రమిసెస్, దే మైట్ బి ఇన్ అ డిఫరెంట్ ప్రమిసెస్, దట్స్ ఫైన్, బట్ దే షుడ్ బి ఏబుల్ టు కమ్యూనికేట్ విత్ ఈచ్ అదర్. ఐ కాంట్ బేసికలీ క్రియేట్ అ క్లస్టర్ బిట్వీన్ టూ మెషిన్స్ విచ్ కెనాట్ కమ్యూనికేట్ విత్ ఈచ్ అదర్. ఫైన్. ఓకే, సో పాడ్స్ క్యాన్ కమ్యూనికేట్ టు ఈచ్ అదర్ బై దేర్ ఐపీ అడ్రసెస్. ఓకే, ఇఫ్ యూ గివ్ నేమ్ to a pod, you can also communicate by name, because yesterday when I executed a command called as kubectl get pods hyphen hyphen all namespaces, we were seeing some component called as kube hyphen DNS. There will be a DNS automatically built in. DNS is domain naming resolution, right? Domain naming service. Yeah, fine. For other pods it's simple, they can communicate basically by the IP address. But what happens if I have two containers in one pod? They'll be communicating via local host. If one container in a pod wants to speak to the other container in the same pod, they cannot use IP addresses because both of them have a same IP address. They have to speak via local host. Okay, good. Okay, So these are the pod states. Pod could be in a pending state, running state, failed state, and succeeded state. Much like Docker. If you see Docker, Docker also have, you don't have a failed state in Docker. You have just started, stopped, and all of that. Okay. So here they don't consider stopping pods. Okay. They basically deal with removing or running. Okay. Fine. Okay. Do we know about this? Do we agree to the, all of this? Whatever you are seeing over here. Yeah. The most smallest unit which you can create in Kubernetes is pod. You cannot go anything smaller than that. Okay. And a pod can have more than one containers. Every pod will get its own IP address. Pods are scheduled on nodes, not on masters. Remember that. Okay. And we can create pods by imperative, declarative, and by programming. And the approach which you are following in this class is purely declarative. Right. Fine. Let us go ahead and create some pods. For that, I have to make the machines up, right? I think I've shut down the machines on the last class. Let me start it and then let me execute the kubectl commands there. Okay, master, node 1, node 2. Node 2, I don't think so. We have joined into the cluster, right? Join chesama na chesinattu gurthu ledhu ma sarle nu chuddam. Okay, good. So let me connect to the kubectl get. Yeah, I've added three. We have one master and the other source. Okay, so if you want to make this go get commands more descriptive, you can use one thing called as minus o while. So that give you more information. Okay, any, you can use this for anything. For example, you can use this the same thing for kubectl get pods. Okay, all namespaces, right? We get this. And now, man, kubeDNS is an error. Otherwise the network work out. Okay, let us see. Fine. And good, it has started. Yeah, so you would get more information when you use ovoid whenever in the get commands, any get commands. Okay, so Kubernetes calls the individual operations which you do as objects, and the objects are pods, services, deployments. Okay, and then you would have something called as replica sets. Okay, so these are all the objects, and you can do, and node is also an object, so you can do get operation on all of this. Okay, so what are the objects? Node is an object for us, at least as of now. Node is an object, and pod is an object, service is an object, and deployment is an object. So everything which you are writing is an object. In addition to that, the thing which we have created, which is called as a node, is also an object, right? Okay, fine. Now I have the stuff ready. So let me, if you want to get some other details about kubectl, you can always use this command. Okay, you will get the whole list of commits. Right. Good. Now, let me go to the folder. Okay. And what I'd be doing on this machine is I'd be installing Git. I'll be doing all of the development on my Windows machine. Okay. And then cloning that repository into the Linux machine. So for the people who don't know Git, okay, Git is nothing but a version control system. Okay. So I will be just writing the code, uploading the code to the server, and taking that code from here. Okay. So for the people who have not learned Git yet, okay. So don't worry, we'll be learning it anyway very soon. Fine. So I'll be writing the code, uploading the code to the Git, and taking the code back on my Linux machine, because here I can't develop, right? On the command line, it is very difficult for me to develop. So what I'd be using is I'll be using a Visual Studio code to develop whatever YAML which you are writing, and basically we'll be using Git so that I will submit all of the code whatever I have written into my GitHub account. Okay, and then I'll be using the same thing on my Linux machine. Fine. Okay, so let me go to the GitHub's location then. github.com/a2zone/kubernetes-zone. Good. I just click on this, clone this, and let me use it on this machine. C drive classroom DevOps. Okay. So Kubernetes zone. Yeah. I'll be using this March 18 folder, and in this trail, there are already some work that is being done. Okay. I'll be creating one more file along on these lines. Okay. So the first thing which I want to create is a pod. So let me open this in Visual Studio Code. Okay. So the files which we are going to create are YAML files, right? So let me go ahead and create a file. I would call it as my first pod.yaml. Right? Good. There is one thing which you have to do in the extensions. Go to the extensions and search for. Okay, there are two Kubernetes extensions which are popular, one from Microsoft, other one basically called as Kubernetes support. Microsoft plugin is helpful whenever you have installed Minikube and want to run it from Visual Studio itself, but our purpose is not that. So if you are exploring Kubernetes on Minikube, ee plugin install chesukunte ikkadunne run chesukochu. Okay, but I am looking out for syntactical checks and giving me help to type certain things. So I'd be using Kubernetes support. All right. Okay. Good. Fine. So in this, I'd be writing my manifest. So the first thing which you have to start with is you have to start with something called as version of the API. What is the version of the API which you want to use? Okay, so generally we have to be careful with these versions, because these versions change with the Kubernetes version which you install. Okay, so for example, let me go onto this machine and just say kubectl version. Are you finding any version difficult, right? So it is 1.9.6. Okay, 1.9.6 is not used by many companies in production. Okay, until the only people who use it if they are on cloud, because in cloud migrating it to the new versions are simple. So the API versions which you are using should be compatible with the Kubernetes version which you have installed. And నేను ఒక ఫైల్ కుబెర్నెటస్లో రాసి నెక్స్ట్ ఫైల్ ఇంకో వర్షన్లోకి మూవ్ చేసినప్పుడు ఆ ఏపీఏ వర్షన్ మారిపోయి ఉండొచ్చు. ఓకే, సో యూ మైట్ గెట్ దోస్ కైండ్ ఆఫ్ ఎర్రర్స్ అండ్ దట్ ఈస్ అన్ రియాలిటీ, వీ కాంట్ హెల్ప్ ఇట్. సో ద ఓన్లీ చేంజ్ విచ్ యూ ఆర్ సపోజ్ టు డూ ఇన్ దట్ కేసెస్ చేంజ్ దిస్ వర్షన్ నెంబర్. ఓకే, సో ఫర్ దాట్ ఓకే జస్ట్ కాల్ ఇట్ యాజ్ ఏపీఐ. ఓకే, అండ్ ద ఏపీఐ వర్షన్ విచ్ ఐ వాంట్ యూజ్ ఎస్ ఓకే V1. సింపుల్, మై ఫస్ట్ కీ ఈజ్ ఏపీఐ వర్షన్ అండ్ వాల్యూ ఆఫ్ ఇట్ ఈస్ V1. సో ఫర్ పార్ట్స్ ఓకే యూ కెన్ యూజ్ V1 బ్లైండ్లీ, బికాస్ ఎవ్రీథింగ్ ఇన్ పార్ట్ వాజ్ సపోర్టెడ్ ఫ్రమ్ డే 1. ఓకే, సో పార్ట్లో V1 యూ కెన్ బ్లైండ్లీ యూజ్ ఇట్, బట్ వెన్ యూ గో టు డిప్లాయ్మెంట్స్ ఐ థింక్ యూ హావ్ టు చేంజ్ ద వర్షన్ దర్. సో V1 మైట్ నాట్ బి సపోర్టెడ్ దర్. ఓకే, సమ్ టైమ్స్ యూ యూజ్ సంథింగ్ కాల్డ్ యాజ్ యాప్స్ స్లాష్ V1, దట్ ఈస్ అ డిఫరెంట్ వర్షన్ ఆల్ టుగెదర్. ఫైన్, నెక్స్ట్ యూ హావ్ టు టెల్ వాట్ ఈస్ దట్ యూ వాంట్ క్రియేట్. ఓకే, దట్ ఈస్ బేసికలీ క్రియేటెడ్ బై ప్రాపర్టీ కాల్డ్ యాజ్ కైండ్. సో ఐఎమ్ టెలింగ్ దట్ ద కైండ్ విచ్ ఐ వాంట్ క్రియేట్ ఇస్ వాట్ ఇస్ దట్ వీఆర్ ట్రైంగ్ టు క్రియేట్ నా P capital, remember that. Okay, and then you would have something called as metadata. So what is the other description which you want to tell about this pod? Okay, so I would just say metadata, and in metadata you can write name and just tell that the name of this is my first pod, right? So whenever you are writing a manifest file, it consists of, first is you tell about what you want to do. So this is simple, right? This is not very difficult. You have said that you want pod, you said that your version is V1, and then you said that my name is my first pod, and then you have to tell about a spec, a specification of what you want to do. So basically a manifest file is a combination of two things. Okay, first is, this is a descriptive kind of a stuff. You are telling about description, you are telling about what you want and all of that, and then you would have a spec. Okay, object info and object spec. Okay, when we go to the next level, we will have basically something like object info and template. Object info and template, but as of now it is simple. Object info we have written, and now I have to tell about spec. Okay, spec, all right? But there is no need for you to remember all of this. I'm telling this again. Okay, go to Google, search for Kubernetes pod YAML example. Take anything. Okay, so I want the stuff to be something like this, right? You can take any example, but any YAML will have this construct. Your metadata can be large. Metadata la manesto. Okay, ippudu varaku labels will come into play whenever we are dealing with services, but as of now I'm dealing with pod. I am not worried about labels, right? Okay, so shall I go with spec? In the spec I want to create what is it I'm trying to tell about? Containers. So I'd be writing about containers, and in this containers you would be telling about what is the container info which you want to create. So I'd basically tell that I want the container, the name of that container, name of the container is my first container. Okay, this name is very important whenever you create more than one container in a pod. If you have only one container in a pod, name doesn't matter, right? Because sometimes when you have two containers in a pod and if you want to get into one container, this name will definitely help, right? But if you are, as of now we are writing only one container, so name, if even if you don't write, nothing is going to happen. The most important thing after name in Docker, what is that we need to tell in Docker? Image. So let me go ahead and say that I'm interested in image, and my image is Nginx or HTTPD or Jenkins or any container which we were using. You can use this. Good. Yeah. So our stuff is done. And now if you want to tell that this application will use ports and all of that, you will be adding additional information to that. So let us look at that at the later point of time. For the first version, this is more than enough. So is it sounding difficult? What is that we have written? We have written information. First information was very simple. I said that I have an API version V1. I want to create a pod. And basically I have some metadata. In metadata, I have told what is the name of the pod. That's it. And then I have came to specification. In specification, I have said that I'm interested in containers. Okay. And in containers, I'm telling about one container. Now, if you see, this is a list item. Okay. If I have to add the second container to the pod, just I would be adding a hyphen over here and writing about the second container name. So let us assume MySQL, image MySQL. So this pod will contain two containers, which is Nginx and MySQL. Okay. But as I said, that is not at all a right design. You should have one pod per container is the best way to deal with it. Okay. Looking good? Simple? Fine. Now what I do is let me commit it and try to use it in my Linux machine over there. Okay. So where is it? Not here. So cd. Added my first pod, first version. Okay, git okay. So let me go to the Linux machine now and let me clone this repository. So where is this repository? So let me go over here. Okay, and then basically say git. I'm trying to show this because this is reality. In whenever you want to make any deployments, you will not be directly given an access to the production server. You have to upload this to the git, and probably you might be just getting whatever version which you want to get and apply the commands. You cannot develop on a production server. You might not develop on a master machine. You would be developing in your laptop, making it available to a master. All right. Okay, fine. Now I have a Kubernetes zone folder, so let me get into Kubernetes zone. And in this, if I'm not wrong, we are in March 18 trails. Okay, and in this trail, pods. Okay, what is that I have written? My first pod. So basically kubectl create is a command which you can use. Okay. So kubectl create hyphen hyphen help. So this will tell you multiple information. You can create multiple things. You can just use the imperative way or a declarative way. And whenever you are using a declarative way, it is very simple. You have to just say kubectl create minus f and give the file name. Because what has to be created, you have written in the file. Even create chayala, file already raster. You wanted a pod, pod had a name, and pod had a container. So there is no need for you to be just telling that kubectl create pod, not required. Okay. So we are just going to write commands which are kubectl create minus f. Okay. So I'll be telling you about one more command which is apply, but that's fine. Kubectl create minus f. And what is our pod's name? My first pod.yaml. What it says? Created. So let us see whether it is created on kubectl get. Yeah, but unfortunately I cannot access this now because I have not, did I expose port? No. Okay. So if you want to get inside the container, probably you can, by using something called as kubectl exec my first pod bin bash. Okay, but you cannot give this to the external world because let me just do one more information about it. Kubectl get pods. What is the next information which would be useful? Why? So on which machine it is scheduled? 172.31.0.0. 6, 15. So let us find out what that machine is. Okay, so let me do first this stuff. Instance state, I'm interested in only machines which are in running state. Okay, and in this he is telling about a machine which has a private IP is not shown over here. Fine. So let us basically, it is not, definitely not master. Yeah, so it is scheduled on which machine? Node 1. So node 1's IP address, you can see it over here. It is 15. So your pod is present on a machine which is node. Right? Now you want to delete this. So kubectl delete, and then you can just tell name my first pod and all of that. But I don't want to do that. I want to make do it from my file itself. So I'll be saying kubectl delete minus f my first pod dot yaml. Oh, kubectl. Right? Simple. So if you write a file, advantages, there is no need for you to worry too much about command line syntaxes. You can basically use create minus f, delete minus f, so that it would be deleting whatever it is created. Okay. But if you use commands, you have to give kubectl delete pod slash, and then you have to give my first pod, which is not that great way. Okay. Fine. Let me execute one more command. Kubectl apply minus f okay. So going forward, we would be using this apply a lot rather than create. Okay, so because apply can be used for creation as well as for changes. Tomorrow if you make any changes to the file, okay, and if you want to basically update those changes, then you would be using apply. So apply is a command which you'd be using there from here, not create. Okay, so apply alone advantage enti, create is only for creating. If you make any changes, you cannot use a create command, but apply can be used for creation as well as changes. Okay, so there is one more command called as kubectl. Let me use help. If I'm not wrong, it is edit. Edit. Okay, good. So we are dealing with this basic commands, by the way. As of now, we are looking with this basic commands. Okay. So kubectl, never do this on production. I'm just showing you basically the stuff. Okay, kubectl edit help, and in the edit also you can just give minus f and file name or resource name. So what is our resource name? Okay, what is our resources name? My first. Okay, so it says it doesn't have a resource called as my first name. How come it be? Okay, okay, is it looking something like where we have done it? Okay, so I'll tell you where I am trying to tell that we have done it. Okay, so we have just given some information and see what Kubernetes is basically trying to do with respect to this. It has a lot of information about your container. Okay, so this is how Kubernetes is maintaining your pod information. All right, so but remember, never do any changes on from here. Okay, edit cancelled, no changes made. You can make the changes from here also. Okay, but rather than this, go to the git, apply the new version. Okay, and then kubectl apply or kubectl commit, kubectl deployment, because in reality you will not be working on pods, you would be working either on deployments or services. ఇండివిజువల్ పాడ్ మనం నేర్చుకునేటప్పుడే వాడతాం. ఇండివిజువల్ పాడ్ ఈజ్ ఓన్లీ ఫర్ లెర్నింగ్ పర్పసెస్. బట్ ఇఫ్ యూ గో గెట్ ఇన్ టు రియాలిటీ విల్ బి డిప్లాయింగ్ డిప్లాయ్మెంట్స్, నాట్ రియలీ పాడ్స్. ఓకే, సో క్యూబ్ జీటీఎల్ ఎడిట్ ఈజ్ ఇఫ్ ఫర్ ఎగ్జాంపుల్ ఇఫ్ యూ వాంట్ ఎ స్మాల్ చేంజ్ టు బి డన్, ఓకే, టు మేక్ దిస్ అప్లికేషన్ వర్క్ ఆన్ యువర్ డెవ్ ఆర్ టెస్ట్ మెషిన్, వండర్ఫుల్, గో అండ్ డూ ఇట్. బట్ ప్రిజర్వ్ దట్ చేంజ్ ఇన్ యువర్ వైఎంఎల్ ఫైల్ ఆల్సో, రైట్? ఓకే, నా క్యూబ్ సిటిఎల్ డిస్క్రైబ్ పాడ్ స్లాష్ మై ఫస్ట్, ఇట్ వుడ్ గివ్ యూ హెల్ లాట్ ఆఫ్ ఇన్ఫర్మేషన్ అబౌట్ ఇట్. ఇట్ వుడ్ టెల్ యూ వాట్ ఈస్ దిస్ పాడ్ అబౌట్, ఓకే, వేర్ ఆర్ ద డిఫరెంట్ థింగ్స్ దట్ ఆర్ బీయింగ్ ప్రజెంట్, ఓకే, వాట్ ఈస్ యువర్ కంటైనర్స్ ఐడి, you can go, you can get a hell lot of things. So this is more descriptive. Okay, kubectl describe and pod slash your pod's name, this would give you more information. All right, okay. Now the thing which I want to do on this pod is, first thing is I want to expose port, and next thing is, once that port is exposed, I want to access it from my machine, from my machine, my laptop over here, to the Nginx which is running in the pods. So shall we make the changes? Okay, so kubectl okay, let me delete this. Fine, now to expose ports, what is it I need to do? I will generally use docker run minus -p and all of that, right? So let me use something called as ports over here, okay. And then let me look at the syntax, man. I don't remember that much. Container port, yeah. So hyphen container port, and Nginx runs on which port? 80. If you have taken Tomcat, you will be writing a container port which is called as Jenkins over here, or 8080 over here. Okay, so this is a port number of your container. Good. So shall we apply this? Wonderful. So let me make this change. So let me be lazy, man. Let me see if I can do something from here. Added. Please don't use this. I generally don't want to use this in my DevOps class, at least, but today I want to save time. Good. Here get full. Okay, so let to verify whether we have our change or not, my first pod.yml. are you seeing the line which I have written? Yes. So shall we apply this now? Kubectl create or apply minus f, okay, my first pod.yaml, okay, and then to see whether the pods are created or not, kubectl get, it says it is running. So if I want to know on which machine it is running, minus o, it says 15. So 15 is which machine? Okay, good. And this machine's public IP address is, okay, so http://. Am I seeing anything? You have just created your port, you have not exposed the port, okay. And pods port, for exposing pod ports, there are two ways, okay. One is basically map it to your node and then use it, and pod doesn't recommend that. Pods basically are somehow against it, okay. So, and to the pod, they don't want you to do that. So there is only one option: never ever use this on your production machines, okay. This is only for testing. the option which I am showing right now, generally don't use it, because in the future what we are going to do is we will create multiple pods and we will link that pod to a load balancer and we'll be accessing the load balancer. That is the reality of Kubernetes. But while developing, you might want to access it, right? Because to see whether your pod is accessible or not. So for that reason, okay, so let me go ahead. Delete this, make one more change over here. In the spec, I would be telling something like host network colon true. Oh, good. Okay. So what is happening right now is your container will be created directly on the network of your node. So generally the node network is 172 whatever IP address it is. So don't never ever use this option until unless you are only developing Kubernetes and you want to just demonstrate the setups, good, but not in reality. Okay, fine. So shall we apply this change again? Okay. More changes. Okay. So get, okay, now shall I create this? So kube ctl apply minus f my first pod dot yum. Okay, now kube ctl get pods minus o white. Okay, so generally if you remember the last o here, the IP address was from 10 dot something, because that was using their own kube proxies network. Now it is basically created in the network of your VPC itself, right? Now let me try doing this. Okay, let me look at the stuff. One not one, right? It was created on actually the other machine. So I'm able to access it directly by your nodes port. You would be able to access it because the pod will internally be created with docker p minus 80 colon 80. That is an equivalent what is happening now. The port equivalent is created, but this is against the best practices of Kubernetes. Pod should not be open to the external world. Pod should not be open to the external world. This we will do only while developing Kubernetes, just to check whether our application is behaving as per our needs or not, right? So host network is something which can expose your pods directly on the same network as your node, but not for even test environment. This is only for dev environments, right? Good. So what is your opinion over this? Looking difficult or simple? Tomorrow if I say that you have to write a pod which has to create a Jenkins, what are the things which are you going to say? Image and probably the names, how you want to call it, and then your container port is 8080. That's the only thing, right? Yeah. So and then you would be again applying kubectl apply minus f, and then you would give that whatever file name is. That's it. That's how we create pods. Okay, and here commands are very simple: create minus f, apply minus f, delete minus f. And whenever you want to get the information, you would be using kubectl get pods or get whatever you are creating resources minus O wide. It would tell you the whole information about it. Fine. So let me go ahead and as usual, okay, pod is just to test. Okay, you will never give directly pods to your customer. You will be creating either a deployment or a service. Remember that. Right? Okay. Now let me look at questions. Can we create multiple pods on the same server? Why not? That's my next topic. Exactly, that is my next topic. Right? So here I have created one kind of pod. If I want to create multiple pods, okay, there are two ways of creating it. One is called as a replication controller, the other one is called as a replica set. In my earlier classes, I used to just discuss about replication controller. Now I want to use replica set, but eventually both are same. Okay, so in replica set, what you would be trying to tell is my kind is replica set, okay, and I want four replicas of this. Four replicas of your spec, and in the spec you write about the same containers. Okay, so if you want to tell about one pod or one kind of a container, you will be writing a pod. But whenever you want to tell about multiple pods, then you will be writing something called as replica set. Okay, so your kind becomes replica set now. Okay, which will have one property which is called as replicas, where you have to give a number whether you want 2, 3, 4 or whatever number of replicas which you want. That's the only difference, right? So replica set or replication controller are basically used to create multiple containers. Shall we try that? Yes. Can we give a specific version in the YAML file? Absolutely, you can give. You can give that. Okay. So you said pods will create themselves in different IPs, but we have used machine IPs. I said disclaimer just now, host network, if you use, it will try to create the pod on your, or basically it will try to give you an access, okay? That never do for production. That's what, that is something which I was screaming for the last 10 minutes, okay? So generally, okay, you will never have this open. You will come into this. Okay, this is only for you to gain access to see whether your pod is behaving correctly or not, right? So pod will never have an IP address until unless you write this host network, but don't use this host network. Yeah, fine. Then it would give you an error. See, there are only two things which can happen with version. First thing is, whenever you are writing, for example, I have written some wrong version over here. Okay. Kubernetes, while getting this, it would try to search in that version. In that version, if there is no definition, it would tell that I don't know what this version is. I have not found it. So you have to Google for a right version. That's the only way. You cannot go just by version saying that, okay, for this, that is a version. Why I am directly writing the right versions is because I felt all the pain and I'm just giving you the right versions. And tomorrow when we deploy this on, for example, if you take pod, it will not create any damage. But after that, I'm going to create a replica set, right? If you go and install replica set, probably with the versions which I have written, in the older versions of Kubernetes, it might throw errors saying that I don't know what this version is. So that is always a different ballgame. The only thing which can help you there is Google. There is no right way around it. And the documentation is, as I said, is not very much aligned towards YAML versions. Okay. The only thing which you can help there is Stack Overflow or a Google. There is no other right way of describing it. Okay. So whenever your version changes, okay, something which was beta might be part of V1. Okay. Sometimes if you go back to the older version, for example, this is a new feature. It is introduced in version 1.18. So app version generally will be V1. But in 1.17, if you wanted to use the same version, you have to use something like V1 beta 1 or something like that. Yeah, that's how it works. We can't help it. Okay, versions, we don't have any control over it. Fine. Create and apply. Yes. Parts you don't change. We will be seeing those changes very soon. Okay. So mirinda ka kubectl edit and command gotter kada. Edit if you have saved it will apply. Okay. So apply is basically for creating and updating. Okay. So for example, you have made the changes in the file again. Then you can just say kubectl apply minus f and give the same file again. So what it will try to do is, okay, it will identify the changes in your file and it will re-update the stuff. That makes more sense when we are discussing on something bigger than pods. So that's why we have not discussed on apply, right? Nodes obviously have to be Linux. They cannot be. No, not really. All the Kubernetes should be on the same version. All the Kubernetes should be on the same version. You cannot have master on 1.8 and node on 1.7. That is not possible because the kubectls might not communicate. Flavors of Linux doesn't matter. Okay. Generally, people tend to use Ubuntu because they don't need to pay for OS. That's the only reason. Ubuntu or CentOS, that's the reason why they go for it. And the reasons in live. Okay. So let me go with replication set. What I want to do is, I want to create the same container, but I want to create two containers. I want to have two Nginx pods with the same configuration. So let me go to the replica sets and create my first RS. Yeah, I have to rename this dot YAML. So API version, this is always a mystery. Okay, so let me find out the API version by googling certain stuff. Okay, that's good. Next here, kind is replica set. Yeah, what is that you want to create? And then you would have metadata again. So what is that you want to call your replica set? So I'd be writing metadata. So if you are doing anything, these things are exactly the same. Name, my first RS. Okay, good. Now let us see other aspects of the replica set. So the other aspects of replica sets are basically, you would have labels there. So let us not worry about labels. Let me go to the spec. Okay, so if you want to go to the immediate character, use shift tab. Shift tab will take you, tab will take you to the next, and shift tab will take you before. So spec, and in the spec you are telling about replicas, and I want two replicas of it. Okay, and then you need to tell about the container info, right? So pods ki deeniki difference artham undi, pods lo manam directly container rasam, because in the pod we are dealing with creation of containers. In the spec we have to deal with creation of pods. So your spec should consist of telling how many pods do you want to create and what is your pods information. How many pods do you want to create and what is your individual pods information? Are we good? Yes. Okay, so now whenever you are dealing with anything other than pod, this template will come into play. Okay, template will tell about something which you are creating. So for example, replica set has to create what? Pods. So in template it would have all the information for creating pods. So I will write the template first. Template. Okay, and in template you would tell the necessary information about your pod, individual pod. Okay, so are we getting the stuff? You would have, initially when I have written this, it was very simple because I was telling about a pod has a container, and my spec was absolutely about it. Now I am trying to create multiple pods, which I call it as a replica set. So my kind has changed, my spec also will change, and in the spec I will have a new field which is called as a template, and template will tell about something which I am going to create. And in replica set, what is that I am going to create? I am going to create pods. Okay, So let us just look at these fields. In template, see what this is. Is it not equivalent to what we have written over there? Okay. So to be very simple on this, I can go ahead over here and then I can say metadata name. See what I write over here. Is it equivalent to my first pod's definition or not? My first pod image Nginx ports . If you see what I am writing in a template, I am writing basically the spec for a pod. Nothing beyond it. Okay. But apart from this, I need to do some things. Replica set identifies the pods only by its labels. And in our metadata, we have not written anything about our labels. Okay. Oh, one thing which is seriously wrong over here is my image is not part of metadata, right? Yeah. Fine. Yeah, spec man. Good. So how can I forget spec? Okay. So replica set can identify other pods only by its labels. So you have to define labels also. And labels are generally defined in metadata. And the syntax for creating them are written over here. So let me not use these many labels. Let me use one simple label over here. Okay. Metadata. Labels, okay, and why am I copying labels name for here? I want to copy only one label over here. So let me just copy one label, which is project, my project. So whenever I have done this, I'm trying to tell that the pods which I am creating will have this label. Okay, so in your office, you can also go ahead and tell that it would have a version and the current version which I'm deploying is 0.1. You can create as many labels as you want. So the pods which you are creating will have basically these two labels, project and version. And in the replica sets spec, you need to tell select all the containers which has these two labels or one label, whatever that makes sense to it. So for that, we would be writing a selector. Are we good? Pods multiple create chesam pod ki label undi kani mi replica set lo em em containers naithe adi contain cheyalo daniki oka logic cheppali ga. You have to tell about one logic. That is exactly this part. So that's why I have not discussed about this at the first. Okay, so you'd be going over here and then you would be saying selector. And what is the other thing? We don't have this label, right? So what is the other label which you have? Version. So even if you don't write, it would select, because all of the two pods will have one label which is called as project. But you can just go ahead and say that version 0.1. So first you write spec of the stuff, you write data of the stuff, and then you will come to spec. And in the spec, if you are creating simple thing, you will just write about something like image. But here I am creating I am creating pods. So in the spec of replication set, I had to tell about number of replicas, and then I had to write a template, and template consisted of nothing but a spec for your pod. That's how simple it is, right? Okay, so shall we see whether this works out or not? Yeah. So if you want to access this, you can use host network. I'm not using it. Nen run chesi run aithe access avutunnanukuntanu endukante in that case I'll come over here and then I will say host network equals to true, then you would be able to access it. So please do it for yourself for testing. Okay, good. So let me go to the git stuff. added replica set . If you have written a replication controller, there is no need for the selector stuff and all of that. You can just say that I'm writing a, I want three replications of the following container. But this is more better than what it is, because you are going to use this in deployment anyway. That's the whole idea. Fine. So let me go into this machine and just say git pull. Okay. And I have to get into replica sets, and what is the file? kubectl. kubectl apply minus f. So it says that you are kind, there is something wrong with this. Okay. So see the version. So what is the version it should be? Apps.v1. It is telling that with your API version, I don't know what version it belongs to. Fine. So updated API version. I wanted to show this error for you. Sometimes if you are getting these errors, it means that the kind which you are telling is not defined in the API version. Okay, so the only thing which can help you at that point is googling that. Push. Good. Yeah. Git. Okay. Now let me try to apply the same command. Okay, good. So at least the error is something different now. So it says that error validating unknown field called as image. Okay. And unknown field called as ports. Okay, good. In the spec, it is in the spec. What is that we have to write? Right. And in the containers, you have to write about. Are we good? Okay. Let us just cross check with whatever is working. Yeah, I think we are good. Okay. Fine. Now, corrected. Okay. Container. Okay, so again git . Now what is error? Invalid type for line number, it would try to tell. So invalid type for pod spec dot containers got map expected array. Okay, so containers, and in the containers you are telling an image, port, name, image is the field, right? Pardon me, which line? Okay, Nginx spelling is wrong. No, but I think it was right. It is right. Not that, that's not the error. Let us see. Let us validate. Is it container? Yes. So containers is a list item or is it an object? You can write multiple containers in a pod, right? So I've missed hyphen, that's the error. Okay, so this I am not going to correct it anyway. I'll just fix it over there itself. Man, sometimes you expect huge mistakes, but actually it is okay. So the error is this, right? And remember, all these three should start from the same character position, otherwise it will fail again. Good. Wonderful. Now what is that we are missing? Name. Good. Let us write it. Okay, name, my first container, right? Okay, good. Let us see what are the other errors which we have. Ah, man, I should not have used tab. Okay. Wonderful. See the problems. These are the problems with the indentation. Okay. It says error from server. Good. While creating a replica set, replica sets in version V1 cannot be handled. Wonderful. I think I have other alternative for it. So what we would do now? Kubernetes replica set example. So if I'm not wrong, the example should be right, but let us see. app/v1. Didn't we use the same thing? Oh God. Okay. Let me use one more thing then. I will try with one more stuff. If it is not working, then let us see. It should work basically. app/v1, right? At least in the latest version, they should work. On a peer on the pitch, no. So let us look at this error. What is saying? Error from server, error creating a replica set cannot be handled as a replica set. APA version. What is that we have missed? Okay, let me try one more thing. So let me use rather than this. Hello, RS. Yeah. So there is something wrong in our file itself. If we compare both, it is not with respect to version. Okay. So kubectl get RS. Okay. So here I have asked for three replicas and it is able to create this. So I'll compare this changes from this to this. So what are the differences which you are seeing? Selector. Fine. Template. Fine. Okay. What are the other changes? Containers. Container name ikkada rasanga dantlo last rasanga. Okay. I will leave it for you. Just go to home, take these two and solve and tell me. I don't want to waste more time on this. Okay. So my first pod, you are the failing one and you have working one, right? Yeah, just try to find out what is the reason. You have to just basically compare between these two things and find out what is the stuff which is basically there. Okay, one thing which I'm seeing is in a replica set I have not created label. Okay, is that really a problem? Not really. Okay, so that's definitely not a problem. So find the other reasons why it has failed. I'll not basically waste time on this. because you have to move forward. Okay, fine. So I am using this in this class. Good. At least I've done this. Okay, fine. Now, unfortunately, in this host network is true. Please don't remove that. That is not a best practice. Yeah, host network should not be the same. Okay, if you use host network, okay, I'll tell you what is the problem. So how many are in ready state? How many should be? Three. Okay, only two are there because I have only two nodes. Yes, because I am using the host network. If I have not used the host network, it would have created two machines. One machine could have two pods and another machine would have one. I am using the host network. So how many networks are available only for me? Two. How many pods I have? Three. So all the three will be up only when you add one more node. That's the problem with host network. So don't use host network. Fine. Now, okay, I want to deal with something called as service. So what is a service? Why we use service for? Rather than dealing every container's IP addresses, it is better that we create a service, and this service will match the other pods which you are creating by the IP addresses of it. So what I would do is, let me just make one more change. Kubectl apply, right? Or let me use the edit part. Kubectl edit minus f, not my hello, right? So fine. Okay, and one more change. Okay, fine. I have edited this. Now kubectl get rs. Okay, are you seeing the state? I have changed the replication steps. Okay, now kubectl get pods minus o. Okay, so there, the host network part is still not applied because that cannot be changed, because host network part is like, to make that change you have to create a new pod. So whenever you are editing, there are certain changes which are allowed and which are not allowed. Okay, so for example, if you want to make these kind of breaking changes, the only thing that can help you is deployment, because in deployment every change which you do in a file is recorded as a new version. Right, so let me go ahead and basically say kubectl delete minus f hello. Okay, and let me make changes to hello rs.yml, and then say that I'm interested only in two replicas and not interested in host network. Fine. Now kubectl apply minus f. Now kubectl get rs. Okay, kubectl get pods, get pods Are you seeing the change now? In the earlier case, the IP address was 172 series, which was my machine's IP address port. Now, what is the series? Good. Okay. The next thing which I want to do over here is, on these two parts, I want to create a service. On these two parts, I want to create a service. Okay. And remember, service also will not be accessible to you directly. Okay. Just like host network, if you want the service to be created, you would be using something called as node port. You would be using something called as node port. Okay. So for that, what I would basically do is, where is my stuff? So go into my older manifest files, and I'm quite sure that you would have something called as svc.yml, and here you have node port. So 80 port is basically accessed or made available on that port number. Okay, but that was an older strategy. Now we use something called as load balancer. But load balancer works only in cloud environments. If you are doing Kubernetes on physical environments, you have to still go with node port. Okay. So my approach of service is I would be using a load balancer, but in my AWS setup, I'll not be able to make it up because I have not set up any load balancer around it. Okay. So service accessing, we'll be doing it in from Azure. Okay. Where my service will look, the only difference if you see over there in this example, what is the type which is specified over here? Node port. And in the example which I want to do, I'd be using the load balancer. This goes and connects to the Azure's load balancer. Okay. And you would be able to access your services on Azure load balancer on port 80. That is what I wanted to do. Okay. So, but let us try to understand this file. This execution, I'll be doing it on Azure, not now. Okay. So, what is the API version over here? V1. This might fail. Okay. So versions, you cannot have, we have seen some version errors, right? So you might get that kind of version errors if you are on, especially on a older version of Kubernetes. Kind, simple. We know what is that. Metadata, some information about that. Okay. And in this metadata, you are telling what is your services metadata, and then specification. What is the type of your service? How can your service be accessed? Okay. If you want to access it directly, you'll be giving node port. Node port means service will be exposed directly on that machine. Here I'm telling load balancer. Okay. So what are the ports which your load balancer requires? 80. Okay. And now selector. Selector is which containers labels does it want to select? Okay. So let me go to Hello RS. Okay. And in this, okay. Yeah, I think I've not done. Selector is basically a label which is called as an app and an Nginx. It will select all the containers, all the pods which have a labels which are app and Nginx. So in our case, we might need to change it to what was it? Project, my project, and role, my front end. That's what you do. Okay. So those are labels. While creating your image, give whatever labels and exactly give the same labels over here. Idedana vachu. Project, my project, environment, dev, test. You can create as many labels as you want. Okay. Fine. This I will be showing you on Azure because it makes more sense there. Okay. Alagani service Azure lone vadala. Ikkada vadakoddu ante node port vadukondi. There is a node ports example already present over there, which I don't want to run through because it is. It will open a port on one of the node. As we already used host network. We have seen the host network exactly does the same. So I'm really not interested in this, but I'm interested in this because this will reduce loads and loads of effort in really how do I load balance and all of that. You have created a service which listens to basically some containers, and that containers are connected to one of the cloud load balancer. Okay, so tomorrow you can use the same thing in EKS also. Remember that you can use the load balancer in Google Cloud also. So when you are connected to the Azure container services, it will speak with Azure's load balancer. If you use a load balancer in Google Cloud, it will go and hit to the Google's load balancer in EKS. In EKS, whenever the EKS comes up, it would go and hit the Elastic load balancer of Azure. But as of now, in our setup, we can't do this because our setup is we created everything. Okay, fine. Okay, so before getting into the last stage of this, I wanted to see what are the other questions which we have. Okay, so how to deploy application related code files and jar files? Ah, what is image? Docker image le untundi? What is Docker all about? Containerizing what? So do I need to worry about jars now? At least at this level? So why do you write Docker file? Why do you write build your images? What is the stuff which we have been doing all of this? Okay, I think basically I want a square zone files. How can I reach it? Just go to github.com/a square zone. Okay, fine. Can we specific version will be given in the, yeah, you can give it in deployment. We are doing that now. Whenever I basically deal with deployment, I'll do that. Okay, fine. Okay, so Venkatesh Reddy, I think mir roju class kostunte edo tappu jarignattu undi. Okay, because there is no need for jar files because we have image. Your the Kubernetes or clustering expects that you have everything ready, right? So you don't build, you build, it assumes that you already have an image which consists of your application and you are just deploying that now. Here you don't go ahead and worry about jars and wars, no, right? Okay, fine, good. The wonderful part is basically the deployment kind of a service. So shall we go with deployment? Yes. Okay, now let me go ahead and clean this machines first. I don't want anything to be running over here. So kubectl apply badlu delete. Okay, so remember about deployments. In deployments we can easily go to the future versions and create versions and we can go back to the older versions if our new version is not working. Okay, so for that we need to start with some version. So let me just basically showcase you deployment.yaml file and let us try to upgrade and change the stuff. Okay, fine. Now looks very difficult, right? Okay, so first one is simple. Okay, let us see this in parts. Till here, do we have any problem? We have exactly been doing this for all the things, right? These first four lines are absolutely common, right? So he said that my kind this time is deployment, version is something, whatever version that sets, and then you have given some metadata about it. Metadata is probably the name of whatever. Okay, and then what is the thing which you have to write after this? After object declaration, what is the next thing which you have to write? Specification, spec, right? Fine. Okay, and in the specification you need to tell about deployment. Okay, so because you are trying to tell about deployment specification right now, and in deployment specification you say that I want 3 replicas and then minimum ready seconds. How much time should it take? Okay, is minimum it will take for a pod to be ready. Okay, you can also have max, I have not put that. Okay, so next, this is important strategy. What is the deployment strategy which you want to apply? Okay, I am trying to tell that my type is rolling update. Okay, and in rolling update, basically what I would try to do in this is I would try to, if I have two containers, two pods, I would make one pod unavailable first. Okay, and then I will increase the new version of the pod. Max surges, you would increase by one, and decrease by one. Okay. For example, if you are basically dealing with thousands or hundreds of containers, there is no need for one. You can go with 10. So for example, if you have 100 web servers which you are on Kubernetes, your replicas are 100. So in that case, you can say that I will be increasing 10 and decreasing 10. So which means that the newer version comes up with 10 containers and the older version 10 containers will be deleted. That's the whole point. Okay. Since here we don't have those many containers, I have given increase as 1 and decrease as 1. Okay. Fine. Till here, any doubts? Okay. Because you have to copy paste and then work out on it. That's why I'm explaining this stuff. Okay. And then selector. Selector is for labels. Okay. Match labels. And you are telling that I am interested in labels, which is for app is Nginx. And if you see over here, this is nothing but exactly a replica set syntax. Apart from rolling update strategy, if you look at what we have written over here, it is exactly a replica set because deployment creates replica sets. Deployment creates what? Replica sets. And to every replica set, it will give you a version. Deployment is nothing but a replica set. And to each replica set, it would give one unique version. Okay. So next template. So what will this template be about? Template in replica set, what was the template about? A container, right? A pod. See whether it is about a pod or not. Yes. Is it about a pod? Okay, pod XML and I, pod YML. Is it not equivalent to this? If you remove API version in the template, you have written nothing but a pod file over there. So exactly that is what is written over here. So first, let me start with HTTPD. Then I will create a version, new version with Nginx so that the welcome pages are different and you'd be able to make out the changes. That's the whole idea. Okay. So I have put host network as true. Again, I'm saying I am putting host network as true just because you and me can access. Don't get me wrong. Please don't use host network true on your production machines. All right. And replicas, let me change it to 2. Because when I did the samples, I had 3 nodes. So I was using all the 3. Now in our case, we'll use 2 nodes. Right. Good. So shall we apply this? Yeah. So what is a deployment? Deployment is nothing but a replica set, to be very specific, with a strategy. Meer kavalante hello rs file idi pakkana pettukoni chudandi. You will not see any differences. The only difference which you see is a strategy. Here you have to tell how are you going to update and how are you going to basically roll back your versions. Okay. Now let me go to our slides, because there are certain commands which would be helpful to you there. Okay. So here you have all the steps. You can follow this one also, right? Let me come now. I'm interested in deployment. I'll come back to the slides at the later point of time, but if you are seeing over here, exactly this is that is the same thing which I have written in there. But in this, you might not have that alignments. So YAML file, right? If you copy and paste, you might not get the YAML syntax itself is right. Okay, fine. So kubectl create, apply. Okay. I will be using these stuff. I'll be using apply and then I'll be saying -- record. Okay, good. So then create one and I'd be using only this. I'm interested only in this. Okay, so good. So let me get into cd dot dot deployments. Okay, and kubectl. One is create. I said that I am not interested in that. Apply -F and then hello deployment. One addition thing which I want to do is I want to use something called as record. Okay, fine. It says deployment has been created. Now, basically, what is my deployment's name over here in this file? My deployment, right? So shall we see the status of the deployment? Yes. So kubectl rollout status and just give. Oh, it doesn't have it. List unto the guy. Okay. Cube. It's okay. There is one more command which can help us. You know, adega ichindi. It's okay. So, manam marchala ikkada. Man local machine lo 3 ni 2 chesam gaane ikkada marchala. Okay, whatever it is. So, the deployment status, we wanted 3 desired states basically it is available right now. Good. Now I want to make changes. So let me execute one more command over here. Kubectl get RS. Sorry, getting a replica set. So deployment is creating what? Nothing but a replica set. So kubectl get rollout -- help. Okay. I think here we have missed something in rollout. Rollout deployment mistake, na? kubectl. Let me Google for the command, man. It's fine. Kubectl rollout. Oh man, this is an API documentation. See, all the stuff which I have been discussing is basically from this documentation. There is nothing beyond this. Okay. Kubectl create, fine. Get deployments, wonderful. And get pods, show labels, rollout status. Yeah, we have missed this, right? Deployment slash. Yeah, that was what you are trying to tell, is it? Okay. Kubectl rollout status. Okay, what is here? Deployment slash okay. So waiting for the rollout to be finished, this is what it says. Okay. Now, basically, you can edit the deployment directly over here and make the changes, but that is not the right way. Again, I'm telling, whenever you do this, that's basically not the right way. Okay. So let me go ahead and kill this or remove this deployment. How will I do that? That's the most easiest thing. So kubectl. Delete -F okay, delete it. So let me make small changes to this file. Okay, so vi, so I know that this is not going to happen, so let me just make this to 2. Fine. Okay, so now let me basically apply the deployment. Kubectl apply minus f kubectl, get deploy L missed. Okay, it is available. So basically, let me go to the AWS's stuff. Okay, am I getting HTTPD? Yes. Now I'll make one more change. Okay, so I think I forgot record. Okay, it's fine. Let us basically look at that at the later point of time. Okay, so now I want to basically make the change in my files. So let me go ahead and basically say vi hello deployment, and this time what I want to basically do is I'll come over here and I would say that I'm interested in an image which is Nginx and I'm not interested in HTTP. This is just because we all have visual change. You can use Jenkins colon 1.6 and Jenkins colon latest. Then you will see a visual difference. All right. Okay. Now, basically, we have seen rollout status, right? Similarly, let me basically see rollout history. Okay. What was the command? I don't want to type all of that again, man. Rollout of, and rather than status, use history. So we have only one revision. If you give hyphen hyphen record, it would give you much more details to it. Okay. So now I want to basically give a new change. Did I made my changes in the file? Yes. So kubectl apply minus f hello deployment and then hyphen hyphen record. Okay, so let me use the same command now. History. Sorry, using the second version. Yes, and now let me get the status kubectl get deploy minus o void. Okay, so it is saying that this is what it is. Okay, now kubectl rollout rather than history, let us use status. So it is saying rollout. Oh, now let me go to this page. Are you seeing Nginx? Good. Now somehow we have found out that this version is not doing good. This version is not doing good, and I want my HTTPD back. I want my HTTPD back. So the thing which you need to do for that is kubectl rollout undo and just name your deployment and say what is the version which you want to go. So shall I do that? Yeah. So kubectl rollout undo and we had version, right? Whenever we see history, so 2 hyphen revision is equals to 1. Okay, now kubectl rollout status. So this is the status. It says that I am bringing up the other machines, old versions are being terminated. Okay, so this was our strategy. If you remember, one machine will be down, the other machine will be up, and all of that. Yeah, so let it finish. Once this has finished successfully, you should be able to see your home. It works back rather than the Nginx homepage. That's the whole idea. Okay, so it says rolled out. Let me go to the page. Refresh this page. Okay, So this is how simple that is. So whenever you go with a new version, something is not working, it is just one command. And during all of this time, you will have zero downtime. Okay, and this is not that simple to implement in any other orchestrations. So for example, we don't have this much amount of maturity in Swarm. We don't basically OpenShift and all of these guys are also taking writing wrappers around Kubernetes to have these kind of features, right? So this is something where it shows the 15 years of maturity what it had. Fine, good. Okay, so now let me just quickly reiterate what we have discussed today. Okay, so we have discussed about writing manifest files, and in manifest files, what are the things which you write? You write about object data. When I say object data, API, what is the kind, and then metadata. And the next section which you would write over here is spec. Okay, and in the spec you would tell directly what is that you want. So for example, in the spec for the kind pod, it is simple because you are trying to create a pod consists of the container, and you have to just tell about the container detail. But if you go with any level which is above than that, your spec is not that simple. So what it uses is, it internally uses something called as template, and template will have the information of what it is creating. So for example, template of a replica set or spec of replica set will have a template which is about your pod. Deployment spec will again consist of the information which is your pod, right? Fine. And whenever you are speaking about a service, you will not have a template there, but you would have a spec which speaks about the labels of your pod, so that it has to load balance between all of that. Fine. So just remember this part, and version conflicts might arise. Please use Google at that point. I don't expect you to remember versions. That's not going to happen, because if two version comes, so we might see many new features where we used to write something as V1 beta 1 in 1.19. There you might directly write V1 because that would be part of V1. So we have to have that change every time, so that we cannot help it. So this is the basic stuff. Okay, and we were trying to describe everything by first important thing which you would read is, first is API version. Okay, next is kind. Kind will tell what you are trying to do. Kind pod, kind replica set, kind service, and kind deployments. Okay, so in reality you will be working only with deployments. Okay, so what is a deployment? Deployment is nothing but a replica set with a version. Generally, when you directly create replica sets, you will not have versions. Deployment creates replica sets with versions and it stores it. Okay, so that you can go to whatever replica set which you have created. So eventually, whenever you are trying to basically say roll out, undo, and go to the version called as one, basically what you are trying to do is create a replica set which is at version one, which is defined at version one. It will create and it would give it for you. That's how simple it is. Good? Yeah. So I think we have 15 minutes of time. If we start even Azure, we'll not be able to even start that instance. It would take 20 minutes to basically create all of this. Okay. So if you go to the Azure, the best part is there is no need for you to worry about installation. The only thing which you need to tell is how many masters do you want and how many nodes do you want. Installation is something which Azure does. And Azure guarantees automatic upgradation. For example, you are using Kubernetes, which was 1.7, and now you want to go with 1.8. So it would upgrade all of the stuffs automatically on the running instance with zero downtime. So these are certain things which Azure Container Services will do it for you. Okay. Now let me look at questions. You have created two pods on two separate instances. Yes. How can we create multiple pods on the same server? Just make the number 4 and don't use host port. Host network vadakunda, okay, give number more than your nodes, then you will be seeing multiple pods. Yeah, any other doubts over here? Yeah, this might look complicated, but try it. It is not that complicated, and don't worry about the YML. Ippudu anavasaramga bayapade edi ante YML meda, ఓకే, నేను రాసినా ఎవరు రాసినా వైఎంఎల్ వీ విల్ టేక్ అన్ ఎగ్జాంపుల్ విల్ కాపీ పేస్ట్ ఇట్ విల్ సెట్ ఇట్ టు ఆర్ సిట్యుయేషన్ ఇట్స్ నాట్ ద వైఎంఎల్ ఇట్స్ ద కాన్సెప్ట్స్ దట్ ఆర్ ఇంపార్టెంట్ ఓవర్ హియర్ ఓకే వైఎంఎల్ ఒక మోస్తరుగా రాసేసిన తర్వాత ద ఓన్లీ కమాండ్ విచ్ యూఆర్ ఎక్స్పెక్టింగ్ విచ్ యూఆర్ ఎగ్జిక్యూటింగ్ ఇస్ అప్లై డిలీట్ ఓకే అండ్ గెట్ క్యూబ్ జిటిఎల్ గెట్ అండ్ యువర్ రిసోర్స్ నేమ్ సో వాట్ ఆర్ ద ఆబ్జెక్ట్స్ విచ్ యూఆర్ వర్కింగ్ విత్ వీఆర్ వర్కింగ్ విత్ నోడ్స్ వీఆర్ వర్కింగ్ విత్ రెప్లికేషన్ సెట్స్ వీఆర్ వర్కింగ్ విత్ పాడ్స్ we are working with deployment so kubectl get deploy kubectl get svc kubectl get rs these are the kind of commands which you would execute there is nothing apart from that okay so can you explain api version again so api version is nothing but when I said kubernetes right kubernetes has a library which is written in go language right and in go language whatever we are dealing with whenever you basically ask kubectl so where it would go and speak with on master which is the component which basically responds to all of this requests api server okay and api server will have some apis right so those apis basically will be defined in some versions okay so while calling to the api server you are telling that I want to create a replica set which is present in your version which is v1 that is an api version nothing apart from that so sometimes what happens is v1 is a production line that is already stable you might see something like v1 beta 1 and all of that that means that this is not yet completely developed but it is on a beta line which is still in use so these beta and alpha these things change every version that's why you might have problems with that api version when you switch versions and that is a known issue and we can't help it that's a problem with kubernetes okay so that is a concept of api version if you are speaking with api server you need to tell what is the kind which you have to create and this kind is present in where okay so that's a api version where we can find that version when we write the code or is there any default v1 is a default version okay and once kubernetes is stabilized everything should be on v1 they might come up with v2 okay as of now to my knowledge they are not working on v2 they are working on v1 itself okay so on a stabilized version you should have everything on v1 okay that's the basic version okay there is no default you have to be explicit about it you cannot be default there but the version which you need to write in your stuff is v1 okay fine okay so what is kubernetes basically trying to do over here imagine that whatever we have done in last 1.5 hours to 2 hours if you have to do by using docker commands tell me how are you going to do roll out and roll back difficult to think right yes and how are you going to create a multi host networking between many containers adding nodes all of that is heavily simplified over here yeah so what are the complexities in kubernetes complexity is this learning curve of really getting this yml up and understanding the errors of kubernetes that's a learning curve okay so we need to also look at logs and some monitoring solutions of kubernetes which I would take with azure okay the service concept and logs concept I'll be dealing with that next week so this week just focus on 3 yml files pod deployment replica set if you are good with these 3 stuffs and don't use nginx use jenkins colon 1.x version any 1.x version and jenkins colon latest so whenever you are making a deployment so that in your home page itself you will see the difference so if it is jenkins 2 it would ask for the password to be entered if it is jenkins 1.x it would directly take you to the home page so that you will understand whether the deployment has happened or not you try with jenkins and your port will be 8080 that's the only difference so try with that's more than enough for at least this week okay next week what we try to do is we try to do this on azure cloud and one thing which I'd be describing on that is logging so how do you get the logs of pods in the kubernetes and I would be demonstrating a cheat sheet right fine okay so is this called as a blue green not technically, but conceptually they are alike. Okay. Yeah. You can think of it as a blue green, but there are some minor changes. Yes. From where these images are pulled? Docker Hub. Because we have not configured any registry. Okay. Fine. So that's what I had. Okay. And next week we'll be discussing about this Azure. Okay. Registry and Docker stacks. Docker stack is the least priority. If it is taking time, probably I might take it at the later point of time. But Kubernetes is very important. You see, whatever concepts which we have discussed, they are very important. Please try it out. Okay. Kubernetes gurinchi telisina vallu chala takku mandi unnaru. Okay, there are very few people who can really work on Kubernetes. So please focus on Docker, and whatever you have learned in Docker, you have learned everything which is required in Docker apart from one concept, which is registry. So how do I, images which I have built, how will I send it to some registry? Okay, so that's the only topic that is missing. Okay, I'll try to accommodate that during the next week. So apart from that, if you look at Docker, we have learned many things. We have learned about volumes. We have learned about multiple networks. Okay, single host and a multi-host kind of a network. And now we are dealing with something called as Kubernetes. So please have answers about all of this. And now the general questions which people come and ask me, I think I've told you in the classes also. So can Docker containers memory be changed? That was not possible earlier, but now it is possible with Docker update command. Okay, please be explicit about your command. Docker update can help you in doing that. Don't say that yes or no. Okay, if you just say yes or no, as I'm saying that, it was impossible earlier. Now it is possible. So even though you have told the right answer, just because the person who is asking the question might not know about Docker update, he might think that your answer is wrong. Okay, please be explicit about your command when answering this. And Docker volumes, right? Docker inspect commands, please go through all of them. Okay, this is a huge subject. Slowly it is turning out to be a very huge subject. When we started, Docker was the less stressful subject for me, because we used to have 2 weeks of time, and Docker had less content than 2 weeks, so we used to do more examples. And now the problem is Docker is slowly turning out to be 1 month's content. We can't help it. Okay, so down the line in the future, when many features come, we don't know, we might have Docker 1 and Docker 2 sequential stuff for 1 month. That's how, by looking at the volume of work and the versions which are being released, I'm just anticipating that. Okay, fine. So are they clear, kada? Object definition, spec. If your spec is complicated, you will have a template. Okay, just remember these parts, and apart from that, if that is just for your understanding, and rest is basically you will take any of the YML file and then you'll be making your changes. So I don't expect you to write your own YML files. Go to Visual Studio Code, install the Kubernetes extension, take my YML files and try to create basically a deployment. Okay, first a pod and then replica set and then the deployment for Jenkins. Okay, so whenever you are using Jenkins, if you want me to be specific with versions, I would be basically saying I want Jenkins colon 1.508 or something like that. Just go into tags and you would be able to find it. Okay, and the other one is Jenkins colon latest. So use this in deployment, right? Good. Yes, fine. So let me stop it at that, and we will not have a class tomorrow. We'll have class on Tuesday, and from Tuesday we'll be starting Ansible, right? And the leftover parts of Docker, let us have the class over the next weekend, right? So my focus will be on finishing Kubernetes and registry. Okay, not really Docker stacking. Docker stacking is relatively new concept, that's my interest, but till Kubernetes is required for your interviews and your career, stack is an extra concept, right? Fine, thanks.
நான் லைனக்ஸ் கிளாஸ் எடுத்துறேன் அதே லைனக்ஸ் பைதான் நேஷனல் லைனக்ஸ் எடுத்து போறேன் இது